by COVID-19, the Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean has produced a series of documents on the evolution and the effects of the pandemic in the region. These publications have been included in the COVID-19 Observatory in Latin America and the Caribbean, which compiles and makes available public policies that the 33 countries of Latin America and Caribbean region are taking to limit the impact of the pandemic, as well as the analysis of the economic and social impacts that these policies will have at the national and sectorial levels. ECLAC studies include a collection of special reports COVID-19 that deal with the economic and social effects of the crisis, as well as sectorial publications on specific topics such as the production of statistics, the right to life and health of older people, people with disabilities, the region's food systems, digitization opportunities, the care system, the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development in the New Global Context, among other topics. This economic and social analysis will be updated as relevant information related to the COVID-19 pandemic emerges. Visit the ECLAC Observatory COVID-19 and access all these reports and updated information on policy measures to face the crisis in the region.
The Escazú Agreement is the first regional environmental treaty of Latin America and the Caribbean and offers an unprecedented tool to tackle these challenges. The Escazú Agreement contributes to the right to a healthy environment and to sustainable development of present and future generations, guaranteeing access to environmental information, public participation in environmental decision making, and access to justice in environmental matters. It is the first treaty in the world to protect human rights defenders in environmental matters.
The Regional Conference on Women in Latin America and the Caribbean is the main intergovernmental forum on women's rights and gender equality in the region. The conference, which was established in 1977 as a subsidiary body of ECLAC, is convened on a regular basis to identify the situation of women's autonomy and rights at the regional and sub-regional levels, present public policy recommendations for gender equality, and undertake periodic assessments of the activities carried out in fulfillment of regional and international plans and agreements on the subject.
The Observatory of Social Development in Latin America and the Caribbean is one of ECLAC's regional knowledge tools. Its creation responds to a mandate of the second meeting of the Regional Conference on Social Development of Latin America and the Caribbean, when the member states requested that ECLAC establish an Observatory of Social Development to support the design and implementation of public policies and allow the monitoring of the trends. This way, the Observatory promotes the integral development of Latin America and the Caribbean with a focus on rights and equality through the analysis of the social situation of the region, public policies, and technical assistance to the countries that request it. The Observatory also integrates a set of digital platforms. The databases are social investment, non-contributory social protection programs, institutional frameworks for social policy, youth and social inclusion, and regional and sub-regional commitments in social development. Through its social development division, ECLAC publishes, updates, and expands these bases, which are available to governments and the general public.
The Statistical Conference of the Americas of ECLAC is a subsidiary body of the Commission whose mandates include promoting the development and improvement of national statistics and their international comparability. Bearing in mind the recommendations of the United Nations Statistical Commission, the specialized agencies, and other organizations. The mandates of the conference also include the promotion of international, regional, and bilateral cooperation between national offices and international and regional organizations, as well as the preparation of a biannual program of regional and international cooperation activities that, subject to the availability of resources, responds to the demands of the countries of the region. The Strategic Plan 2015-2025 of the conference establishes as main lines of action the institutional strengthening and leadership role of national statistical offices, the development of human resources and statistical production to ensure their quality, and regional and international coordination and cooperation for the development of official statistics in the region. The 10th meeting of the Statistical Conference of the Americas, to be held from the 19th to the 21st November 2019, will bring together authorities and representatives of the national statistical offices and national statistical systems of ECLAC member countries to discuss the future of economic statistics in Latin America and the Caribbean,
good morning,
among other topics.
all of you who are present in this fiscal panorama for Latin America and the Caribbean.
Latin America is home to 826 indigenous peoples, which by the year 2010
bear
included nearly 45 million people,
away from
accounting for 8% of the region's
of
population. The countries with the greatest proportion of indigenous peoples are Bolivia, Guatemala, Peru, and Mexico.
So
there is huge diversity among indigenous peoples, with some remaining in voluntary isolation and others coexisting in big cities. Brazil has the greatest amount of indigenous peoples, followed by Colombia, Peru, and Mexico. Indigenous peoples represent one of the most disadvantaged groups in the region.
Here we are already with our Alicia Bárcena. I'm asking the technical team whether the audio is okay. So we immediately begin with this fiscal panorama. Good morning, thank you, or good afternoon for some of the countries in the region. Welcome all to the launching of a fiscal panorama for Latin America and the Caribbean 2021, the annual report of ECLAC. This is a virtual meeting within the framework of the fiscal regional fiscal policy seminar, and this is what we've been going on for many, many years, high level opinions on policies, economic and fiscal challenges in the region. This is being seen as of Santiago through a Zoom platform, and naturally we all will be able to follow this transmission through the ECLAC.org website, www.cepal.org, and you can also follow this through the social media. We greet all of you who are with us, especially the journalists who have joined us, as well as the colleagues from UN system and ECLAC who are following us from your homes during these times of pandemic. We are all meeting through virtual technology. Now, our executive secretary, Ms. Alicia Bárcena, will be delivering the main conclusions of the report. Madam, you have the floor. Thank you very much. Good morning and good afternoon to all of you who are participating in this meeting. And thank you, first of all, for being interested in this presentation and this tremendous topic that is so important and so crucial due to the pandemic we're all facing. I will now share my screen to bring to you the fiscal panorama as prepared by ECLAC. I hope you can see it. Please confirm. Indeed. First of all, I'd like to thank all the members of the team for this effort, the team from Economic Development at ECLAC, and Mario Cimili, our Deputy Secretary, and many other divisions that have been contributing, especially gender affairs, because this fiscal outlook includes a chapter on gender perspective that is so important nowadays. I will now go to the subject at hand. We are facing very complicated scenario, undoubtedly, even though we hear about what's going to happen with the growth during this year. We'll not be able to offset the drop in 2020. And naturally, the growth this year will be subject to strong uncertainty because of the unequal access to vaccines and also the vaccination process that is complex. And naturally, we'll afterwards take a look at the efficacy of these vaccinations. The governments have been making tremendous fiscal efforts, 4.6% of GDP, and some above 10%. And that has been able to offset some social and economic impact. Now, the continuation of the pandemic and the weakness of the economic recovery process demand the prolongation of these fiscal measures during the whole year and even up to 2022, even though the capability of to maintain these expansive monetary and fiscal policies are different from country to country. We expect slow growth in the next few years that will make it difficult to recover employment, as well as tackling informality. More than 54% of workers in the region are informal, and to change the increase in poverty and extreme poverty. We are now noticing that the inequality is deeper. The in technology-intensive sectors will recover faster in a region that is known for low productivity and for the fragmentation of social protection and health systems. And the impact is greater amongst women because they have suffered a decade of shrinking labor participation. Now, what about the recovery and what are the risks involved? First of all, the recovery will be different and asynchronous. And not only the access to vaccination, but the effectiveness of the vaccination is a fact. High global indebtedness, especially in the mid-income countries, 96% of GDP, except for China and India. And in our region, more than half of our economies have a high-risk credit rating. The risk raters have dropped our rating in many of our economies, and that added to the possible increase in long-term rates may create more volatility in the financial flows into the region, or perhaps the outflow from the region. And the global initiatives for debt alleviation that have come from G20 are not, for the time being, including mid-income countries. And that is of the utmost importance. For this year, as I said, we expect a growth of global economy at about 6%, but with big differences between countries. There are two strong economies for our region, and these are USA, that will grow about 6.4%, and China, 8.4%. These two economies are very important, and they are very strong trade partners. We can also see that this year the region may have a positive growth of more than 4%, but we will not be able to recover the activity we had in 2019. So there was a big drop of 7.1% last year, and it will be difficult to go back to what we had. And if we were to grow at 1.8, only by 2023 we'll be able to see the activity before a pandemic. Now, in the last few 6 years of 0.3%, if we were to have that, we will have to take a whole decade. Now, fiscal policy last year has been very important. Let us take a look at the fiscal deficits because they went up as a result of the drop in public revenue. Less activity, less income, and also because of the increase of public spending that went up at 24.7%, coming from 21%. And naturally, the revenue dropped 18.4% from 18 up down to 17. So we have a primary deficit of 4.2 and a full deficit of 6.9. We can also see what's happening from country to country with the primary result as disaggregated by countries in Latin America. Here we're not including the Caribbean, by the way. We saw a drop in tax collection, and that was the main factor behind the shrinking of public revenue. Tax revenue dropped 0.5%, and not tax did not go up. And here we have a big variation in the total revenue of the countries. Almost all countries, with some exceptions, had big drops in their total revenues. Now, the fiscal deficit went up. And by the way, we already saw this graph. Let me push ahead. Yes. Now, the region has also faced an increase in public debt vis-a-vis GDP. And that has been generalized, showing greater indebtedness and drop of GDP. That is how this index is calculated. And we also saw an increase of 10.7 points of GDP, reaching 56.3. With a look at country to country, there are some countries with a debt that has increased tremendously, Argentina, Brazil, for example. But this combination, on the one hand, of more indebtedness, on the other hand, of drop of GDP.
Por encima del promedio, ¿verdad? Y este aumento de 10 puntos porcentuales, lo cual es para la región un tema. En el Caribe, la pandemia provocó que los niveles de deuda pública superaran el 100% del PIB en algunos países. Ahí nosotros hemos destacado la enorme vulnerabilidad que presenta el Caribe, no solamente por el alto endeudamiento, sino la vulnerabilidad frente a los desastres naturales. Y vemos que hay países cuyo resultado primario aquí se observa entre 2019 y 2020, pues tuvo caídas muy importantes y por lo tanto ahí vemos que, digamos, y el aumento de la deuda pública bruta del gobierno central, muy importante a su vez. Vemos el caso de Barbados, no tenemos todos los países, pero la mayoría tuvieron problemas muy graves de aumento de la deuda y caída del PIB, por supuesto. Además, el turismo en la región caribeña fue uno de los sectores más afectados. Aumentó también en el Caribe el peso del pago de los intereses sobre el PIB. Y esto al Caribe le afecta muchísimo, porque el pago de intereses tiene mucho que ver con justamente este déficit en el gasto, porque hay que pagar estos intereses, y como son países considerados de renta media y en algunos casos renta media alta, pero con calificación de riesgo también alta, pues esto hace que el pago de intereses sea muy alto para el Caribe y que afecta realmente sus finanzas públicas de manera muy extrema. La región presenta además mayor nivel de endeudamiento respecto a las economías en desarrollo, sin duda cabe, pero menor a las economías desarrolladas, ¿verdad? Respecto al mundo, o sea, América Latina en promedio tiene un 77,7% de deuda pública bruta del gobierno central, ahí sí, uniendo a América Latina con el Caribe, y ahí lo que vemos es que es mayor a la deuda de nuestros países, es la que tiene mayor endeudamiento respecto a economías en desarrollo, menor respecto a las economías avanzadas, que están en 120% del PIB. Claro que la diferencia es que el servicio de la deuda de las economías en desarrollo es 5 veces mayor. O sea, estamos más endeudados que el mundo desarrollado, pero nuestro servicio de la deuda es 5 veces mayor que los países, por ejemplo, del G7. Este es un gran tema que a nivel multilateral e internacional debe visualizarse. La carga de los pagos de los intereses aumentó en la mayoría de los países. Ya vimos el caso del Caribe, aquí vemos el caso de América Latina, y lo que nos preocupa es que el pago de intereses sigue subiendo, ¿verdad? Ha ido subiendo desde 1,7 en 2010, ahora estamos en 2,7 en 2020, sube, y con respecto a gastos de salud, vemos que es mayor el pago de intereses que lo que gastamos en salud. Y ese es un tema que también preocupa. Vamos a ver también la comparación de pago de intereses con inversión, que también es un tema para nuestra región muy importante. Entonces, la variación anual del pago de intereses es en aumento, ¿verdad? Con excepción de Brasil y Argentina, por otras razones, pero ahí casi todos los países tienen un aumento en el pago de intereses. Y lo que hay que destacar, sí, es que a pesar de esta situación de déficit fiscal, de menores ingresos, de mayor, obviamente el mayor endeudamiento fue justamente para lograr aumentar el gasto público, que fue el instrumento esencial para mitigar los impactos sociales y económicos de la pandemia. ¿Qué duda cabe que este gasto público se incrementó de 21,4 a 24,7, ¿verdad? Y el gasto corriente 18,6, el promedio de la región, donde más aumentó fue sin duda en América del Sur, ¿verdad? Ahí fue donde más aumentó el gasto público. También en Centroamérica, ¿verdad? Vemos México y República Dominicana. En general, todos los países aumentaron su gasto público. El gasto primario, miren ustedes del lado derecho, se ve claramente cómo ha aumentado este gasto primario del gobierno central. Entonces, no hay duda de que la política fiscal jugó un papel muy importante en 2020 para mitigar los efectos sociales y económicos de la pandemia. Como ya dijimos, 4,6% del PIB en planes de emergencia fue lo que esta región ha destinado justamente de sus arcas fiscales y 2,5% en promedio en garantías estatales de crédito. En 2021, ¿verdad?, ya tenemos anunciados 1,2% del PIB en planes de emergencia. ¿Objetivos de esto? Bueno, es apuntalar salud, ingreso de hogares y la capacidad productiva, sobre todo de micro, pequeñas y medianas empresas. Y los mecanismos son alivios tributarios, gasto público, y también instrumentos de liquidez que el gobierno también pone a disposición. ¿Qué esfuerzos acordes con las características de cada país? Obviamente todo ello, este 4,6, pues es variable de acuerdo a la estructura de las economías, el espacio fiscal disponible, la capacidad que cada país tenga de movilizar financiamiento adicional, el alcance de sus sistemas de salud y protección social. Por ejemplo, países como Uruguay o Costa Rica, con sistemas de seguridad social más amplios, no tienen que invertir tanto como el resto, que tenían grandes fragmentaciones en su sistema de salud, por ejemplo. Y por eso,
because of that, countries with these broader systems have had capability to react more quickly, and many of the countries have extended this into 2021. The larger increase accounts for subsidies and current transfers to households. Let's look at the case of Argentina. Strong subsidies and current transfers are to poor households. Brazil, Chile, Colombia, Salvador, Peru, but Dominican Republic, countries that have actually supported very strongly current transfers or transfer payments to households, but also to the productive sector. We've seen in some cases subsidies to salaries, subsidies for businesses, and that must be highlighted as well. What has been the role of public spending in emergency monetary transfers? One that is very important, which is mitigating the increase of poverty and extreme poverty. Of course, there have been measures of this type of emergency measures in terms of money transfers. Poverty would be even higher compared to the one we experience today. Of course, poverty increased in all cases, poverty increased and extreme poverty increased. But we are comparing here. If there had not been any transfers, poverty would have gone from 30.5 to 37.2. We are at 33.7%. So it increased anyway, but at a smaller rate. And extreme poverty would have gone from 11.3 to 15.8. We are at 12.5. This is the largest effect in terms of extreme poverty. That is to say, we would have 230 million people, and we have 209 million, a strong increase anyway, of 187 to 209. And from those, extreme poor are 78 million. And those would have been 98 million extreme poor individuals who are also suffering because of lack of access to basic food basket. These efforts have been focused on supporting production activities. And what governments have done is to provision or to provide guarantees for financial institutions in order to develop. The allocation of guarantees has been extremely important in countries such as Argentina, Brazil, Colombia, Chile, Ecuador, Mexico, Paraguay, Peru, and Uruguay, from $12.2 billion to $56.3 billion. So a significant guarantee allocation for the banking system and financial institutions. In this outlook or panorama, we propose a strategic look for public spending. Why? Because there are two major challenges among many others, but two major: to expand a fiscal space and to sustain an expansionary fiscal policy. How to strengthen public revenues, and key is to eliminate fiscal illusion and to reduce taxes in order to favor certain companies or institutions. Access to international finances in better conditions, even in some cases on a concession basis, to increase tax collection, consolidating income tax to property tax, the scope of property tax, wealth taxes, and environmental taxes. A better distribution of income is essential. This is key because without income distribution, growth is not sustainable. We have said this on several occasions. And to rethink public spending as a development tool, not only as an instrument to foster domestic demand, we need to see it as a development tool that links the emergency with transformative recovery that supports the supply, of course, the supply side that supports households, but also at the same time that makes investments for the future in transformative sectors that may create jobs, especially for women, for the young population, and with a smaller environmental footprint. And for all that, we need social pacts, social agreements, fiscal pacts, and political agreements as well. Those new political agreements and pacts, we need to create a new level of consensus in society that is completely appalled by the situation. They're looking for a new future, a change in the type of development that will allow us to close the inequality gaps, that will allow us to actually adopt actions in favor of fighting climate change, and especially universal access to healthcare and social protection. That is what the pandemic has shown, that universal access to healthcare and social protection is key for society to really find its well-being. So the region needs to focus its expenditure for transformative recovery, but linking it to short-term demands with long-term investment, employment growth, being very careful in terms of the technology change in technology inclusion, because we have 46 million households that are not connected in the region. And the urgency of investing on care, in a society of care, a society that actually takes care of the environment, that takes care of the elderly population, that takes care of children. In that sense, women play a paramount role. That's why we talk about a society of care. And the proposal is to keep emergency transfers at least during 2021, which has been called the emergency basic or emergency family income, with under different names, to support for micro and small businesses, intensive investment on job creation, but decent jobs, formal jobs in strategic sectors that also actually find gender equality. Production development connected with technology development and climate action as well, using innovation and cleaner technology, universalization or streamlining of social protection systems. This is a society of care that we want better schools. We don't want the same schools that we had before. We want to improve in terms of education systems. And this will, of course, demand increased public spending in time. It is essential to reverse the drop in investment. We said this before, the relationship between investment and GDP is the lowest at the global level. Our region is at 17.6% of the GDP compared to what we actually invest, actually, and compared to other regions. If we see developing in emerging markets, they invest 32.9%, and that's key for their rapid growth and their inclusion. We also see the European Union investing 21.5%, has dropped a little bit, but investment is still the major bridge between the short term and medium term. And we have proposed that there must be a virtuous interaction between a welfare state and production transformation, with technology inclusion, but also with job creation, but most of all, which capacity building, endogenous capacity building. So we need to build our own capabilities. We saw it in the case of vaccines. We need to build, and that's why we mentioned here healthcare manufacturing industry that actually strengthens our capabilities in the region, because we cannot continue to import absolutely everything, and we need to produce locally within the region, for example, such as the case of pharmaceutical inputs or medical inputs. And in other areas, we need to build in capacities, transitions. For example, the countries that produce lithium are producing batteries locally for electromobility, and not everything from import. That is connected to renewable energy, sustainable mobility in cities, digital revolution. We need to jump on this digital revolution wagon. But universal access, bioecology, the industry of healthcare, economy and services, ecosystemic, the economy of care, circular economy that is becoming an industry with a lot of power, and sustainable tourism that is so urgent for Caribbean countries.
Por eso este documento propone, quizás es que propone una mirada estratégica del gasto público con enfoque de género. ¿Por qué? Porque necesitamos asignar gasto público a reducir las desigualdades de género en la respuesta y en el largo plazo. Tenemos que analizar con mayor cuidado los efectos distributivos de las políticas fiscales. No son neutrales en los ingresos, en los gastos, en las inversiones. ¿Cómo incorporamos realmente el enfoque de género en todo el ciclo presupuestario? Asignar recursos suficientes para servicios claves que ejercen las mujeres, empezando por la economía del cuidado, ¿verdad? Pero también darle a aquellas mujeres que perdieron empleo, ¿verdad?, en esta pandemia, que son alrededor de 70 millones, poderles, yo diría, dar un ingreso básico de emergencia, porque son mujeres de las cuales dependen muchos de sus hogares, son jefas de hogar en muchos casos, o son las que tenían el ingreso. Y, por supuesto, universalizar la protección social hacia todas las mujeres. Garantizar que las reasignaciones y recortes no les afecten, y sobre todo en el financiamiento. Y, desde luego, medidas que puedan proteger el ingreso y los empleos de las mujeres. Y, en ese sentido, invertir en sectores, ¿verdad?, que son muy intensivos en tecnología y innovación, capacitar a las mujeres, darles toda la inclusión digital que se requiere, y también potenciar aquellos sectores muy afectados por la crisis, el comercio, los servicios, etcétera, el turismo. Compras públicas que puedan ayudar a las pequeñas y medianas empresas encabezadas por mujeres, la inclusión financiera, qué duda cabe, y una inversión fiscal, como decía yo, para incluir a todas las mujeres en el mundo digital. ¿Qué políticas tributarias para aumentar el espacio fiscal? ¿Qué políticas para distribuir el ingreso? ¿Y qué proponemos para justamente lograr esta trayectoria sostenible del gasto? Bueno, en primer lugar, para fortalecer la trayectoria de los ingresos públicos y la capacidad redistributiva de la política fiscal tributaria, primero eliminar la evasión, que asciende a 6.1% del PIB, 325 mil millones de dólares al año. reducir la evasión de las corporaciones multinacionales y de personas físicas a través de paraísos fiscales y traslado de beneficios. Los paraísos fiscales, ¿verdad? En Europa tenemos paraísos fiscales. Acuerdos multilaterales para reducir la evasión fiscal y los flujos financieros ilícitos, porque la evasión se va a algún lado, ¿verdad? Pues se va a los paraísos fiscales, se va justamente a estos territorios que reciben este tipo de flujos. Acuerdos multilaterales para establecer una tasa mínima global para el impuesto a la renta corporativa. Esto ya se está discutiendo, ¿verdad? Se ha hablado entre 21 o 25%, en eso está el debate internacional. Un impuesto solidaridad que se ha llamado, o a la riqueza, para que se ponga un impuesto a la riqueza a aquellos que han tenido ganancias muy sustantivas por la pandemia y que pueda ayudar a financiar la emergencia, las vacunas. Consolidar el impuesto a la renta a personas físicas y corporaciones. Extender el alcance de los impuestos sobre el patrimonio y la propiedad, ¿verdad? Aparte del impuesto solidario, ¿eh? Esto realmente tiene que tener un alcance mayor. Impuestos a la economía digital, a los temas ambientales y a los relacionados a la salud. Y revisar, sí, revisar y actualizar las regalías de las industrias extractivas. Si nos comparamos con la OCDE, veremos que en tema de renta, ¿verdad? América Latina realmente la estructura tributaria es muy regresiva en términos de impuesto de la renta. Comparándonos con la OCDE, estamos, bueno, prácticamente en la mitad. En tanto que en bienes y servicios, que es el impuesto al valor agregado, ¿verdad? Que es el regresivo, ahí sí estamos un poco por arriba de la OCDE. Por eso es que tenemos que revisar nuestras estructuras tributarias con seriedad, con profundidad y con mirada de futuro. El impuesto sobre el patrimonio vuelve a estar en el debate global. Este impuesto al patrimonio forma parte de los impuestos a la propiedad y se aplica sobre el patrimonio neto, que es la diferencia entre el valor de todos los bienes y derechos que posee la persona, los activos, el valor de las deudas que mantiene, los pasivos, o sea, se descuenta, y hay casos en que se aplica sobre el patrimonio bruto, sin descontar las deudas. Y aquí ponemos algunos ejemplos. En Estados Unidos se propone el impuesto anual 2% a patrimonios netos, entre 50 y 1.000 millones, ¿verdad?, con una sobretasa de 1%, a patrimonios mayores a 1.000 millones. Vemos el caso de tres países en América Latina que ya aplicaban un impuesto al patrimonio: Argentina en términos brutos, Colombia en términos netos, Uruguay en términos netos, ya antes de la pandemia. Y en Argentina se está haciendo un impuesto extraordinario al patrimonio con objetivo de financiar los costos de la pandemia a personas con activos superiores a 2 millones de dólares. Esto es, ayer incluso estuvimos conversando sobre esto con las autoridades financieras de finanzas de la región. Bolivia, un impuesto recurrente a las grandes fortunas, ¿verdad?, para gravar a personas naturales con patrimonios superiores a 4,4 millones de dólares. Y Chile, que está discutiendo un proyecto de impuesto por una sola vez a patrimonios superiores a 22 millones de dólares para financiar los costos de la pandemia. Y esto, pues eso es valorar el alcance de los impuestos de la propiedad y el patrimonio y hacerlo justamente en un contexto de bajo ingreso tributario, de baja progresividad y de creciente desigualdad. Así es que eso lo proponemos seriamente. El financiamiento para el desarrollo. ¿Qué es lo que la región necesita? Primero que nada, entender que somos la región del mundo en desarrollo que tenemos los mayores costos, el mayor servicio de la deuda externa en relación a exportaciones de bienes y servicios. Es decir, nuestra restricción externa es enorme, agravada porque la deuda, el servicio de la deuda, miren ustedes, nosotros tenemos que destinar 59% de las exportaciones de bienes y servicios de la región al servicio de la deuda. Esto nos pone realmente un traje de fuerza muy difícil. Miren cómo aumentó. De 50,9, en realidad subimos a 59%. Y en los países emergentes, ¿verdad? Esto es menor, pero aún así sigue siendo muy alto. Pero nuestra región destina más de la mitad de los ingresos de las exportaciones de bienes y servicios al pago del servicio de la deuda. Esto tiene que revisarse. Es muy elevado, además, en economías pequeñas y en particular es muy delicado para el Caribe, que representa 30% de los ingresos del gobierno, y hoy día que los caribeños tienen menos ingresos por la tremenda caída del turismo, esto es un problema muy severo de carácter estructural. Ampliar el espacio fiscal requiere también aumentar y redistribuir la liquidez desde países desarrollados a países en vías de desarrollo. Una forma es esta emisión masiva de derechos especiales de giro que se está debatiendo y que está cerca de ser acordada, ¿verdad?, por 650 mil equivalente a millones de dólares, y también debe complementarse con la reasignación de los derechos especiales de giro que no están siendo utilizados por las economías que los tienen, que tienen un superávit de derechos especiales de giro, pero hay que hacerlo bajo nuevos criterios y nuevos mecanismos, porque no hay, digamos, debe haber mayor equidad en esta distribución, porque generalmente se va nuevamente a los países más ricos, y en cierta medida proponemos incluso la creación de un fondo fiduciario. Los derechos especiales de giro, además, tienen una serie de ventajas sobre otras facilidades de crédito y líneas de financiamiento del Fondo Monetario. Son un derecho imprescriptible y automático de todos los países miembros del Fondo Monetario Internacional. Los derechos especiales de giro no son crédito, no generan deuda, no conllevan condicionalidad y generan una tasa de interés muy por debajo de la tasa del mercado, del uso de los derechos especiales de giro. O sea, es una forma de financiamiento, ¿verdad?, más barata, porque tiene menores recargos asociados a la duración y al monto. Y lo comparamos con otros programas del fondo, ¿verdad? Por ejemplo, las líneas de crédito flexible o el nivel de ingreso del nivel de ingreso de los países, el Poverty Reduction and Growth Trust Fund, que se aplica a los países de ingreso bajo, las facilidades de financiamiento, incluso las líneas de emergencia que se han utilizado como la línea de crédito rápido, que llevan generación de deuda. Y todos los programas del Fondo Monetario no asociados a la pandemia tienen condicionalidades muy complicadas, con costos sociales muy significativos. Los programas tradicionales del fondo, como la facilidad de extensión del fondo, aplican recargos muy significativos a ciertos países. Nosotros estamos analizando estos recargos, por ejemplo, que afectan al 30% de los países. Argentina es un caso, Ecuador es otro caso, Barbados es otro caso, que tienen programas con el fondo. Y hay que decirlo, el financiamiento del fondo, el 50% del financiamiento total del fondo, proviene de estos recargos que afectan a los países altamente endeudados. La emisión de derechos especiales de giro fortalecería la posición externa de los países, qué duda cabe, disminuye su riesgo y puede liberar recursos para los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. Porque los países, como decíamos, no tienen que incurrir en costos adicionales para que sí lo tienen la acumulación de reservas internacionales. Las reservas, como sabemos, es el principal mecanismo para hacerle frente a los choques externos. Y una nueva emisión de derechos especiales de giro beneficiaría sobre todo a las economías pequeñas. Aquí nosotros hacemos un desglose del total, de la tenencia total de derechos especiales de giro como porcentaje de los activos de reservas si se hiciera esta emisión de 650 mil millones de dólares, ¿verdad? Son cifras a abril del 2021. Y aquí vemos que economías pequeñas, ¿verdad?, serían muy beneficiadas, ¿verdad?, porque ayudarían a elevar el porcentaje de los activos de reserva, por ejemplo, en Guyana, obviamente 37%, en Jamaica 17%, en Argentina 14%. Entonces, pues sí, es muy importante para nuestros países. Y una nueva emisión debe complementarse con otros mecanismos, ¿verdad?, de reasignación. Por ejemplo, un fondo fiduciario que podría ser muy importante para que los países que tengan estos derechos sin utilizar, recién emitidos, ¿verdad?, pudieran destinarlos voluntariamente o temporalmente, ¿verdad?, a reforzar capacidades financieras, incluso de, yo diría, de la banca, ¿no?, de la banca de desarrollo, instituciones financieras, las bancas regionales, el FLAR también, por ejemplo, el Fondo Latinoamericano de Reservas, bancos multilaterales de desarrollo, regionales y subregionales, y los derechos también especiales de giro pueden aumentar la capacidad que tienen estas instituciones para apalancar recursos, que eso es lo importante. Y la banca de desarrollo podría emitir bonos que el Fondo Monetario puede intercambiar por derechos especiales de giro. Estos son algunos de los caminos que nosotros podríamos, estamos proponiendo que se exploren, porque entonces los bancos podrían utilizar estos derechos especiales de giro para otorgar créditos concesionales. Hoy la banca de desarrollo otorga créditos, pero a tasas muy altas también, muy similares a los bancos comerciales. ¿Qué instrumentos se pueden desarrollar para complementar el aumento de la liquidez? Esto debe complementarse, por cierto, con una reforma integral de toda la arquitectura financiera internacional. Por un lado, generar y instrumentos, ¿verdad? Creación de fondos multilaterales para una mayor cooperación internacional, como el FASE, el Fondo para Aliviar los Efectos del COVID, que propone Costa Rica, con un fondo de 516 mil millones de dólares, sin condicionalidades, para todos los países, independientemente de su ingreso, ¿verdad? Medianos, bajos, altos, y que sea de largo plazo. Y fortalecer la cooperación regional, como ya dijimos, de instituciones financieras regionales y subregionales. La reforma de la arquitectura de la deuda multilateral es muy importante. Se requiere un mecanismo multilateral de reestructuración de la deuda que traiga a la mesa a los acreedores y a los inversionistas privados, que se incluyan cláusulas de acción colectiva.
We include collective action clauses, something very important. What happened to Argentina with the voucher funds, there wasn't these collective measures that when you have serious agreements with the major creditors to include the rest, collective or class action, to incorporate the support of international financial institutions that would provide credibility to the debt renegotiation, avoid fragmentation and different solutions that would generate greater uncertainty. And you need to include in the debate the role of risk rating agencies. And of course, innovative instruments to increase the capacity of reimbursement of the debt. Innovative instruments like, for example, with put here some cases of clauses, of hurricane clauses, or bonds linked to the national income that would allow to accompany economic cycles and the ups and downs of economic cycles that jeopardize the payback capacity of countries and sustainable development goals. Countries here, we've seen some issuances on green bonds, social bonds, sustainable development goals. Ecuador did it, a sovereign social bond of $400 million to fund this program, A House for All. Guatemala with bonds for $1.2 million that was especially used for COVID-19. Chile, sovereign green bonds for $1.6 billion and to fund and a social bond as well of $2.1 billion in order to finance support to homes, education, and health. Mexico that issued a sustainable sovereign bond linked to sustainable development goals for 750 million euros, innovative instrument that is being assessed in other countries in order to fund education, health, water access, energy development, and infrastructure. In sum, five messages. One, to consider public spending as a development instrument, linking emergency with recovery. In emergency, to finance transfers and emergency income supporting productive sectors, and medium term, we should consider universal social protection. Number two, multilateral debt renegotiation mechanisms, especially for middle-income countries that will supplement liquidity with other innovative instruments and initiatives. Number three, tax on solidarity or wealth, especially those that have obtained major revenues in this during the pandemic times, and that will help to finance emergency. And there are some that remain in time, especially those property taxes. Sustainable path of public spending. How can we rethink tax spending, consolidate direct taxes on income, property, equity, green taxes, and two on the extractive industries. And finally, fiscal and political pacts that will synergetically contribute to growth, to investment, to in climate action with decent employment, assigning, allocating resources to economy of care and inclusion. This is what, dear friends, today we present in this fiscal panorama. And of course, we will respond to your questions through our platform. Thank you very much. Thank you, Executive Secretary. The presentation of the annual document, the fiscal panorama of Latin America and the Caribbean of 2021 has been the core and part of this 33rd regional seminar on fiscal policy. And just say that yesterday, this seminar began, was opened with the attendance of ministers of finance of Latin America and the Caribbean. Today, it has been the launching of this annual document, Fiscal Panorama. Tomorrow, so that you can continue attending tomorrow at 10 a.m. Santiago time. It's minus 4 Greenwich Meridian. At 10 a.m. Santiago time, to jointly with OECD, IDB, and CIAT, the document on tax statistics of Latin America and the Caribbean. And then the regional seminar on fiscal policy will give an account of all these seminars to be followed openly in the social media and ECLAC at 12 o'clock on regional fiscal policy viewed from international organizations at 4 p.m. Santiago time. Once again, GMT minus 4, fiscal policy for a transformative recovery that is gender responsive. And on Friday, we will conclude this seminar with also sessions on challenges for financing and having an expansive fiscal policy and transformative recovery in middle-income countries. And then fiscal collaboration priorities for the region. And we conclude with a seminar on climate financing in Latin America and the Caribbean on Friday at 3:30 Santiago time. Alicia Bárcena, jointly with authorities from Spain who have collaborated for holding this fiscal seminar, will close this 33rd regional meeting on fiscal policy. About the today's document, it's available. And in the press release, we'll summarize, and all the information can be provided in our webpage and contacts. I know there are hundreds of you. We thank you for attending the launch of this document. Highly productive. We appreciate your attention and remind you that tomorrow we'll have the entry into force of access to information and public participation, access to justice and environmental matters in Latin America and the Caribbean, the Escazú Agreement. We'll have that, and we'll have our executive secretary attending that. It's an extensive session and having also the entry into force of Escazú. Executive Secretary, any final comment, any final question? No, no. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I know that we have been with international organizations, country representatives, and thanks to the great team of ECLAC for this great support and panorama or outlook that is going to be so helpful for the coming months for all those who are interested in topics of tax, fiscal policy, and transformative recovery demanded by these times. Thank you very much, Executive Secretary. With this, we conclude this the launch of this fiscal panorama in Latin America and the Caribbean in 2021. And it's going to be in the public information of ECLAC available to all of you. And at the same time, answer any questions or views. We will resume or meet again very soon. And tomorrow is the entry into force of Escazú, and then continuing with the fiscal seminar. We will see you soon. Thank you, Alicia Bárcena, for your time and your very clear expression and explanation of this document. Thank you and goodbye.
In the very year that the United Nations launched the Decade for Action to ignite a more purposeful understanding of the part of the international community towards advancing the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, the world has confronted unprecedented change in the specter of COVID-19. The multidimensional impact of this pandemic has served to dramatize the true scale of the vulnerability of the small, heavily indebted, undiversified economies of the Caribbean, and has forced creative exploration of every opportunity within the reach of our member states to secure urgent relief. The 2020 meetings of the Caribbean Development Roundtable and the Caribbean Development and Cooperation